ومن يعش عن ذكر الرحمن نقيض له شيطانا فهو له قرين وإنهم ليصدونهم عن السبيل ويحسبون أنهم مهتدون حتى إذا جاءنا قال يا ليت بيني وبينك بعد المشرقين فبئس القرين صدق الله العظيم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. In one of his hadith explains how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this world and what the position of human being in this world. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the nature of this world is that it's full of hardships and difficulties. And to explain the point, he drew a line. And then he said to Sahaba radhiyallahu alayhi majma'in that the lion is a human being, and then he draws a box around it, and he says these are all the hardships and difficulties that are surrounding a human being in this life. In another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there are 99 hardships that are always attacking human beings. If he walks safely out of all of these 99, the death is going to come and get him. So there is no way of running away from these hardships and difficulties. This is how everything is. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran al-Kareem that we have assigned angels with every human being to protect human beings. If these angels were not assigned with each and every human being, shayateen and jinn would just come and snatch the flesh of human being and destroy him in parts and pieces. It's the protection that is provided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through these angels that are keeping the shayateen and the jinns away from human beings, from destroying the human beings. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still has given some power to these shayateen, and that is mainly the power of whispering, which is not too strong of a power, but still, for us, something gets into our mind, sometimes it becomes too difficult to get it out. And this is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was raising the Sahaba radhiyallahu alayhi wa sallam, one of the main points he taught them was, you always obey your leaders, your amir. Obey your prophet. When you're going out on a journey, then assign an amir and obey the person. Don't always just use your own brain. Don't depend on your own understanding, because you don't know where shaitan will come and take you from. And this is why he again and again reminded us, Yad Allah ma'al jama'ah. Allah's help is always with jama'ah. A person who has the habit of staying away by himself and making his own decisions, going on his own way, that person, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the person who is under the control of shaitan. This is the person that shaitan will try to attack the most, and shaitan has power over him. He knows that this is someone that I can really use the way I want. As some of his scholars have explained, those who see the youngsters, the senior others who are not around them, and they're following the shayateen, they're going under the, they're just following their desires. They say that the way they see all the other human beings reacting to the whispers of shaitan is just like when people are playing with the ball. Everyone is kicking the ball the way he wants. And the ball keeps on bouncing between these people. So they say when we look at people who are obeying the shayateen, this is how you always see them. The shayateen are just kicking them here and there, and these people are bouncing between the shayateen. Which if we really look at it, it's a reality as soon as you start looking out there. How shayateen are kicking every person and make the person run this way, that way, our way. Stay away from your family, stay away from your parents, stay away from your education, stay away from your responsibilities. Go to the club, go to these places, go and commit crimes, and go and commit haram, and every halal is available, but run after haram. You see the person just bouncing between the shayateen. Of course, this is through that whisper, the power of whispering that shayateen have over human beings. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His kindness, His rahmah, His mercy for human beings, He also taught us how to protect ourselves against the whispers of the shayateen. So now you can see that He has closed all the doors of shaitan getting to the person. That's it. This was the only door that was open for him. If you even close this door for shaitan, that's it. Where else is he going to come to you from? There is no way that he can get to the person. That's the only door. Through whispering. Yes? Whispering can come in two different ways. النبي يوسوس في صدور الناس. The one who whispers in the hearts of the minds of the people. من الجنة والناس. Sometimes he comes in a form of a jinn, shaitan comes in his own form to whisper, and sometimes when he feels that, no, this person is staying away from me, then will not also use his people also. Go and tell them to do this. So, whether he comes in a form of a human being, there are human beings that are working for shayateen. There are jinn that you want not. Human beings that work for shayateen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about those people in the Quran also, inshaAllah. I will be referring to those ayahs soon. But first thing, let us see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala closes that door of the whispers also for the shayateen, so that shaitan will not be able to get to the prison. That's it, you close all the doors. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never gave him the power to control us, to hold us and pull us away. You never see shaitan holding your coat and pulling you away. Are you entering the masjid? He's standing at the door of the masjid. No, go back. He has no power. The only thing is, a person driving the masjid in Japan will come, you know, you have some other things to do. That's the whisper. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us in Quran. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explains in the hadith that there is one thing, very easy tool that you can use so that you can close that door for the shaitan. That's it. So that shaitan will not have any access to your mind, to your brain to whisper. And that is the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in the hadith, when a person starts remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, shaitan comes and sits on his nose. And through the nose, shaitan keeps on whispering to the person. Because from the nose, you have straight access to the brain. So shaitan keeps on whispering to the person through the nose. The wording of the hadith are, فَإِذَا ذَكَرَ اللَّهَ خَنَفَ. When the person does the zikr of Allah, remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, shaitan moves back. Shaitan moves back when he hears the remembrance of Allah. As soon as the person forgets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he neglects the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, shaitan comes back. And starts whispering again. This is ongoing process. He never gives up. But yes, we can keep him away through the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ومن يمشي عن ذكر الرحمن نقيض له شيطانا. Whoever turns away and neglects the remembrance of Rahman subhanahu wa ta'ala, of this merciful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then نقيض له شيطانا. Then we assign the shaitan over this person. But as soon as the person remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's visiting the remembrance of Allah and the zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the shaitan moves out. As soon as the shaitan moves out, the doors to these wasawis are closed from shaitan. Now, of course, if a person is coming back to the remembrance of Allah after 5 years, after 10 years, 10 years when neglecting us, and we allow shaitan to keep on whispering continuously in our mind, then, of course, although a person is in the zikr of Allah, he is remembering Allah, and he's closing all the doors to the shaitan, still those thoughts are going through this person's mind. Why? Because our mind is used to thinking in that direction now. Because for a long time, shaitan was continuously making our mind go through those type of thoughts. He was whispering continuously in our mind. These are facts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are revealing to us. Facts that we can never find them in any other book of this world. No other source of knowledge will give us this information about our reality and reality of our thoughts and our understanding. How does our mind function and work? This is just like if a person keeps on spinning. They spin for a few minutes. And after those minutes, when you stop, you feel that your head is spinning. And the person is falling. Although you stop spinning now, he's not spinning anymore. But because of that spinning now, his mind is going that direction. And he feels that he's still something now. As he stops, he feels that the whole world around him is spinning. This is exactly what happens after the whispers of shayatin. Shaitan stops at the remembrance of Allah. But our brain keeps on going about it. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, when the adhan is being called, shaitan goes away. He cannot stand the adhan. He cannot stand those words of the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. He goes so far away that he won't be able to hear the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the call of him to the prayer. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Such disliked words by shaitan that he goes so far away that he cannot hear the adhan at that point. In fact, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith, أدبر الشيطان وله براد. He keeps on blowing the wind while he goes away so that he won't be able to hear the name of Allah and the greatness of Allah and the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He can't stand these things. So imagine when a person is deciding it. Do you think shaitan is with the person at this time? No. He goes away. But as soon as we stop and we get involved in other things, now shaitan tries his best to get involved so much into it that you never think of coming back to that remembrance. That will keep me away. And then we find ourselves getting so much into it, away from the remembrance and busy with other things, that even when we have nothing to do, we never even think of coming back to the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes days go by and we don't remember that we really sat and we even thought of doing some remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With putting our thoughts and our mind into it. Yes, we come to the salah very quickly, let's run out of it, and after the salah, which salah, which surah did the imam recite? Well, I don't know. How many rakahs did we do? No one in the masjid would know. What did you say to do? The person in flow doesn't realize and recognize it. Although we know the meaning of it. And this is why a lot of time I tell people that shaitan comes and tells us, you know, you cannot concentrate in Salah because you don't know the language. Listen.
قد أفلح المؤمنون الذين هم في صلاتهم خاشعون والذين هم عن اللغو معرضون والذين هم للزكاة فاعلون والذين هم لفروجهم حافظون إلا على أزواجهم أو ما ملكت أيمانهم فإنهم غير ملومين صدق الله العظيم
ورسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم came to the world at that time. When we look at the history, we can say that in reality that was the days that deserve to be called the days of Jahiliyyah, the days of ignorance. And then when you look at that ignorance, there are many different aspects of that ignorance and Jahiliyyah. But the main thing that was the cause of all of that Jahiliyyah that follows them. There are many different things that people look at, and especially when it comes to historians and they analyze the days of Jahiliyyah. They would mention examples from the history, how people were treated, and how people used to live, their dealings, and everything else. But in reality, the main cause of all of that Jahiliyyah was one thing. And that was people forgetting their Creator subhanahu wa ta'ala. Forgetting their Rabb subhanahu wa ta'ala. And not only that they had forgotten Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself told us that the situation was such that when the name of Allah was mentioned before these people, they would get upset. They're harsh, and not only that, they're pretending. No, Quran says, الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ إِشْمَأَزَّتْ وَإِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ إِشْمَأَزَّتْ قُلُوبُ الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْآخِرَةِ. When only Allah's name is mentioned, then the hearts of those who do not believe in Akhirah, their hearts start shrinking with sadness. The feeling in the heart, they don't want to hear the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is how badly they had broken away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't want to hear the name of Allah. And then the ayah goes further to say, وَإِذَا ذُكِرَ الَّذِينَ مِن دُونِهِ إِذَا هُمْ يَسْتَبْشِرُونَ. When other objects beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are mentioned before the very same people, they get happy. They rejoice. Their hearts open up. This is good. This is something good that I have heard. Imagine when this becomes a situation of a person, then when the name of Allah is mentioned before this person is there getting upset. You look at his face and you see that he is disliking it. His mood is off. He doesn't want to be in this company anymore. And when other things are mentioned where he feels that he can benefit from, then this person gets happy. And you look at his face, you see the expression of happiness, rejoice, can be seen on his face. How low human beings must have got at that time when this was their situation. That the dislike Allah, the dislike hearing about Allah, the dislike talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they celebrate and they get happy when they hear about other people. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he came,
His first message was, the first thing every person got to do was
start establishing your connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing is going to work without it.
If you break your connection with Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you can do anything else.
It's not going to be of any help to you. These things will end with this dunya. Everything ends, these things will end, you will end, nothing that you will take back with you for akhirah.
And if you look at the gist of all the message, the whole message of the Nabuwa of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam,
this is the gist of it, connect yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
But now you are talking to such people that even when you mention the name of Allah to these people, they dislike it. They don't want to hear it.
And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala changed the situation with such.
وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ وَارْكَعُوا
لَا يَرْكَعُونَ When they are asked to do ruku' fell down before Allah, said no. Not before Allah. After the battle of Uhud, Abu Sufyan, later on he became Muslim, radiyallahu anhu. At that time he was leading the Kuffar of Quraysh.
He announces, "Ta'alu Hubal," that today Hubal is the highest.
The person is celebrating that Hubal, what is Hubal? Name of one of the idols. That is in Makkah. Who doesn't even hear his voice.
And he is happy that today Hubal have defeated Allah wal'ayadu billah.
According to his understanding in that time.
This is the situation.
وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمُ ارْكَعُوا لَا يَرْكَعُونَ They are asked to bow down before Allah, they don't want to do it.
And they're going bow down before anything else.
And at that time, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is trying to convince those people, listen,
the only way you can get anything, you can do anything good, and you can have any success in this world and akhirah is by establishing your connection with Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no other way.
No way that you can find any other way. You have to connect yourself to your Rabb subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is your creator. He is your Rabb. He is everything for you.
Without going into too many details of that portion of the seerah,
or we may call it that portion of the history,
we can see how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam succeeded in bringing that change. And when the change came, the same very same people about whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said they did not want to hear the name of Allah,
now the situation was such
that when Allah's name is mentioned before these people,
وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ their hearts start shaking with love and fear for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
The people who didn't want to even remember Allah, they would be upset to hear the name of Allah, their situation is
يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقْعُودًا وَعَلَى جُنُوبِهِمْ
Quran witnesses. Allah is witnessing for them.
They remember Allah standing, sitting and laying down.
At all times these people remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now for those people, remembering Allah was the greatest thing in the life. They would enjoy the ibadah of Allah, the remembrance of Allah more than anything else in the life. Now their situation is such
that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has to convince them at many different occasions,
brothers, you need to rest, you need to sleep, you need to have some rest also.
Don't be up for the whole night.
And they're seeking permission. No, ya Rasulullah, please, we want to drink.
He says, no, I have to rest. In one of the situations, he has to come up and announce,
إِنَّ لِجَسَدِكَ عَلَيْكَ حَقٌّ Your body has a right on you. ولعينك عليك حق. Your eyes have right on you. ولضيفك عليك حق. And your guests have right on you. ولنفسك عليك حق. Your own life, your soul has a right on you. ولزوجك عليك حق. And your wife has a right on you. This is when those people who were running away from it, they tasted the name of Allah. They didn't just recite it. They tasted the sweetness of the name of Allah. When they came into the ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they realized that what we were missing throughout our life, looking for it everywhere, trying to achieve it by killing people and prove that I'm brave, trying to become wealthy, trying to become leaders, trying to control people, do all of these things, I never got it. I was never able to achieve it. And here, as I come to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he's teaches me how to connect myself to Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala, find that this was everything for me. The person doesn't want his business, doesn't want his wife, doesn't want his children, doesn't want nothing. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, yes, I got you what you wanted, but doesn't mean you neglect everything else now. Now he's trying to convince them, no, you have to do these things also. What brought that change into their life? When they trusted Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this was his message, trust me, that I will show you the right path. I will teach you how to connect yourself. They trusted him. They started working on the directions given to them by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Within a short time, they found the peace of mind that they were missing in their lives. Ala bi dhikrillahi tatma'innul qulub. The peace of mind is in the remembrance of Allah. They found it there. And now, we just want to compete with each other in doing that. Once, some of the Sahaba radhiyallahu anhum ajma'in, young ones, as they got into the ibadah and they felt the ibadah, subhanAllah, they feel that there is no way I'm going to miss a single moment of my life without doing my ibadah. So they come and ask Aisha radhiyallahu anha, Ummul Mu'mineen, please tell us something about the ibadah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Aisha radiallahu anha informed them about the ibadah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari says, فَكَأَنَّهُمْ تَقَالُوهَ. They felt, no, we can do more. And now, they're discussing to each other that, look, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is doing only this much because all of his sins are forgiven. But we need to do more. He had none of his levels. His connection is established already. And he is already there. You know, we need to do something to be in those levels. And one of them saying, while they're sitting now outside of the door of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that is in the masjid, one of them saying, I would never be sleeping throughout my life, never sleep over during the night time. My whole night will be up during the ibadah of Allah. The other one says, yeah, but in addition to this, what I would do is, I would be also fasting for the rest of my life. Not a single day in my life would go by that I'm not fasting. The third person says, yes, but I don't think this is enough. I want to add one more thing, and that is, I will never get married. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes home. Aisha radiallahu anha informs him, ya Rasulullah, these three people came, they asked me these questions, and then this is what they were discussing amongst themselves. Sure. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent another sahabi. He said, go and call all three of them. When they came, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ya Rasulullah, he asked him, did you people say these things? Yes, ya Rasulullah. وَمَا أَرَضْنَا إِلَّا الْخَيْرِ. Our purpose was only to achieve something good. And then the thought informed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ya Rasulullah, after asking about your ibadah, we thought we should do more than that because we consider you to be on a very high level. You don't need that much, and we need more. So this is why we thought we should always do more than what you do. The hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, Aisha radiallahu anha says, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was extremely upset. He was upset with them.
And then he taught them the right way of doing the ibadah. So do some ibadah during the right time and have some rest. Fast some days, and then some of the days, don't fast. Because you see me doing all of these things. This is the real thing. And فَمَنْ رَجِبَ عَنْ سُنَّةِ فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي. Whoever turns away from my sunnah, he is not of me. The point I'm mentioning here, when these Sahaba رضوان الله عليهم, when they tasted the ibadah of Allah, when they got the real taste of it, the sweetness of Iman, then they just wanted to do more and more and more of it. And these are the very same people, Quran mentions both sides of them. Quran mentions their situation before coming to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and after coming to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Read Surah Al-Muzammil. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in detail talks about the tahajjud of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I just want to quote one ayah out of the surah. إِنَّ رَبَّكَ يَعْلَمْ. Indeed, your Lord knows. Your Lord sees and He knows. أَنَّكَ تَقُومُ أَدْنَى مِنْ ثُلُثَيِ اللَّيْلِ. That sometime you do tahajjud little less than one third of the night. It means close to one third of the night. One is far. Little less than two thirds of the night. أَنَّكَ تَقُومُ أَدْنَى مِنْ ثُلُثَيِ اللَّيْلِ. You do tahajjud little less than two thirds of the night. Which means more than half, but little less than two thirds. This was the situation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One is far. Sometime you're up for half of the night, and half of the night you would rest. وَثُلُثَ. And sometime you're up for one third of the night. Allah says, I know when you're doing this. When you're up and doing the ibadah, I'm happy with the ibadah. And وَطَائِفَةٌ مِنَ الَّذِينَ مَعَكَ. And the group of the people that are with you, I know they are doing the same thing also. They are doing the same thing. They are up during the night time. Some of them two thirds of the night. Some of them half of the night. Some of them one third of the night. So this became the situation of Sahaba radhiyallahu anhum after coming to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Before going to the next step, and that is, what were the steps that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took to bring the change in their life? From this to this point, that as we see both sides in Quran, what did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam do to bring the change in their life? But before going into that, we need to answer a question. We see two sides. One of those sides, where do we find ourselves standing? On what side? The side of those who did not come yet, or came and learned from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and now this is their situation. Where do we stand? When a person comes to us and he talks to us about deen, what is the feeling in our heart? When a person starts talking to us about Quran, about Salah, about fasting, about Zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, these different issues of deen, what are the expressions of our face? How do we feel in our hearts at that time? That these people don't know nothing else. This is all they know. They don't know where the world has gone now. And they're just talking about those few hadith that they have learned. When a person in the same gatherings come and talks to us about other worldly things, where we feel that we can benefit from this, he's telling me how to develop my business, how to maintain my car, how to maintain our home, how to lower the taxes. That's very good. Savings for me. He is going to save a few dollars in my life. Good. Great topic. I want to go and learn more about it. Where do we stand? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us both the pictures. People in this Jahiliyyah and people after coming to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the kingdom came into their life. Unfortunately, it's very sad to see that we are not even in the middle path. It's not that we have even thought about, let's see if he's in the middle, okay, I don't get upset with this line. If someone talks about Iman, Deen, Quran, I don't get upset. It's when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اشْمَأَزَّتْ قُلُوبُ الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْآخِرَةِ. The hearts of those who don't believe in Akhirah, when they hear the name of Allah, they hear the name of the Deen of Allah, they hear about the Book of Allah, their hearts started getting very, they started shrinking with sadness. They don't want to hear it. But it's life they tell them. Don't you hear something better when it has to be done? And what could be better? If the change has to come often from the same exact same direction, we have to adopt the same ways as Sahaba Rizwanullahi alayhi wa sallam adopted for that change to come. The same teachings that were given to Sahaba Rizwanullahi alayhi wa sallam, they still stand for us up to this day, and they are valid for us, and they are the same, they will bring us the same benefit as they brought to Sahaba Rizwanullahi alayhi wa sallam. There's no other way. If those people were the greatest people of the Ummah, then for sure we have to follow them and do the same thing as they did to get what they got. And if God forbid anyone feels that no, those people didn't do what they were supposed to, then we have to find some other way of life. And Quran is very clear about it. Clearly, after seeing both sides of the picture in the light of the ayahs that we just recited, let's look at the change that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam brought, and very quickly, how did he bring that change? And we won't go into all the details of it, but the first step, and if we start with that, inshallah, this will be enough for us at least to bring a huge change throughout the Ummah. And if you need the gist of the whole thing, is one word only, not more than this. And that word is called Salah. There is nothing else. It's Salah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he told the Ummah the Salah, he told us one thing about it that we always need to remember. بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَالْكُفْرِ تَرْكُ الصَّلَاةِ فَمَنْ تَرَكَهَا فَقَدْ كَفَرَ. The thing that holds a person into this deen is salah. A person who will start missing it, he will fall into kufr. Very simple. And repeatedly he kept on making this announcement. In many different occasions you find Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would mention this statement, that remember, the thing that is holding you in this deen is salah. In one of the hadiths, very well known hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, As-salatu imad al-deen. Salah is the foundation of Islam. Never. We saw people around us. Our own family members, our children, our sons. They brought the foundation and they were breaking it. Brick by brick. They were breaking it. We never cared about it. We never cared about what these people were doing to their deen. Finally, a deen comes. When this person says, who is Muhammad? What is this book? I don't enjoy reading it. One of the parents comes and tells me that his son says that I don't like singing Quran, I like the other songs better. His son told him this. Now this person is worried. What happens to my child's iman? It didn't happen to me. It happened the day when he became 7 years old and the Prophet of Allah والسلام, told you, مُرُوا أَبْنَاءَكُمْ لِلْصَلَاةِ السَّبْعِينَ. Ask your children to perform salah when they are 7 years old. And make sure by the age of 10, they are very punctual and regular in doing the salah. And we never cared about it. They are 14, they are 19, they are 22. No salah in their life. I wake him up, he doesn't wake up. What can I do? I told him so many times and he doesn't want to do it. And then you ask him, why doesn't he do it? He says, you know, even he doesn't do it many times. When we brought the foundation of our deen with our own hands, at that time, no one complained. Now we start looking at the whole world, look, those people are doing this, other people are doing this, these people are destroying deen. They're not doing nothing. They are not doing anything new, more than what we had already done to our school. We demolished it within our own homes. How many families now that you can find who really taught their children Salah at the age of 7 and they made sure by the age of 10 everyone is doing Salah punctually on time? We didn't do the Salah, we are not eating today. Go do the Salah first. We won't wait for you. So when these things, when this thing came out of our life, we demolished the foundation of deen. Now we see the whole building falling apart. And we are complaining. Well, how come the building is falling apart? It's not just falling by itself. We demolish the foundation. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was saying goodbye to the Ummah, just imagine what would have been the feelings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, rahmatul alameen sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who spent the whole life just worrying about the Ummah. The whole life spent worrying about the Ummah. Now, he is departing. Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam comes and asks him, what do you want to do? Love a little more or go back? And he says, bil rafiq al-a'la. No, I want to go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He sees the angel of death. He has to say the last words to the ummah, last message to the ummah. We hear two words from him. As-salah wa ma malakat aymanukum. Take care of two things. O my ummah, O my followers, take care of two things in your life. Salah and your slaves, people who are under you. Make sure you take care of these two. How important these things must be. That as he's uttering the last words, last message of our Prophet, beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to us, to the whole ummah, was as-salah. Take care of your salah. What does this salah mean? Yes, we occasionally do the salah, or some of us are doing it punctually. But we need to see what type of salah did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught the ummah. He taught a specific way of salah. I know that we have learned how to stand up, bow down in rukur, go down in sujood, and sit down in qa'dah, in the shahud. But salah is beyond this. What did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teach about salah? What type of salah did he teach Sahaba Ridwanullahi alayhi ajma'in? And what type of salah Sahaba Ridwanullahi alayhi ajma'in used to perform? Inshallah, in our next session, we will talk about the salah that was taught by Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I don't mean the physical account for the salah that you recite three times in Subhanallah Rabbi al-A'la, and then you get up and you sit in this form and you handshake it like this. I don't mean that. That's something that we normally learn it by seeing each other. But there is something much deeper than this that will bring us the real benefit of salah. We need to learn those things. They are not difficult. They are easy. It's only learning them and making sure that we pay attention to what we are doing at the time of doing salah. Inshallah, in our next session, we'll talk about those. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give all of us tawfiq to learn our deen the way it was taught by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and give us tawfiq to connect ourselves to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وأستغفر الله.